joining us online this morning. It is good to gather together to worship God. And I would invite you to stand if you are comfortable and join me in a prayer this morning. O Spirit of God, warm our hearts with the love of God and of Christ, that we might be awakened to our opportunity to give our best to worship and serve you today and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And friends, we gather together in the name of the risen Christ. And so I invite you to hear these words. Peace of the risen Christ is with you. Take a moment to greet those around you with signs of peace this morning, and we'll gather back together on your own.
Good morning.
Welcome again to worship. I'm Pastor Mary Ivanov. I'm grateful to worship with you both here in our sanctuary and for those who are joining us online today. If you're worshiping with us for the first time, we're grateful. If you've been connected here for a long time, we're grateful and we're glad we're together. We pray for the Holy Spirit to do this work in all of us, to bring us the deeper faith and hope and love in Christ. We light our candle this morning as a reminder of the light of Christ that is always with us, that guides our steps, that guides our lives, and that no matter where we are, we seek to walk in the light of Christ. And we would welcome those of you who are joining us online. If you have a candle near you, you can light it as the same reminder to show that you're worshiping with us as well. Leave any comments online or put your hands or high. It's always good to know we're gathered together. We have a new sermon series today, a new worship series, and you see a little difference up here. I want to thank our worship community team for their work to prepare this space. We're looking at the call to discipleship in our lives. Now, we do that all the time, hopefully, but we're going to be, over the next 10 weeks, being really, really focused on a list called the United Methodist Canon, created by a colleague of mine, Reverend Jeremy Smith. So we're going to look at 10 different things that remind us who we are, and today we're going to focus on mission. I'm sure that it will be time for all of us to better understand how we're connected, all who follow Jesus, and how our Wesleyan Methodist heritage forms us today. Those reminders are always good. Some of you may have gone through a membership class for confirmation or something like that a long, long time ago. And so those reminders always help us to remember what it is we're about and how we can continue to live out that call in our lives every day. So that's where we're headed today and over the next 10 weeks. And I pray that God would help us to move to deeper faith in that time as well. So I invite you to stand if you're comfortable and able, and invite Larry's sister to guide us in our call to worship this morning.
Good morning. We gather today to worship the one who created us, the one who calls us, the one who equips us and sends us into the world to make disciples, the one who loves us with all that, with joyful and grateful hearts, who worship God.
We're going to sing the first 3 verses of O 4,000 Points to Sing. And as we're going through this series, we're going to be singing some of the hymns that are part of our Wesleyan Methodist heritage. This one is written by Charles Wesley, Brother Tim Young. Charles Wesley wrote many, many, many hymns. This is one of them that's probably a little more familiar to us, so let's sing these first 3 verses together.
For a thousand times to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My grace is master and my God,
gracious God, we can trust you with the grace of sin. We know how we can live, but we fail to live it anyway. It's time to stand for that. Let me bear your image and lead us as people. We have forgotten to live in this house and justify it for us and all our acts of selfishness. We have ignored the voice of your spirit speaking from our house. And we have filed the desire of our own heart, which is our own will. We serve as a thought, whether it is for you or our neighbors, our lives of humanity, our witness of this disciple, and our image within us as we see one. From the middle, good Lord, Jesus Christ, by this Spirit, guide our vision and disciple us in our own life.
As we gather, we offer those prayers to open our hearts to God's redemptive love, to God's saving grace in Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. And so I invite us to hear these words of grace and promise. The Lord who saves us says, I am the God who forgives your sins. I do this because of who I am. I will not hold your sins against you. Praise God for grace and forgiveness. Glory to God. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And I would invite those who are young and young at heart to play special attention for a few moments. First of all, I'm going to invite you to, on the count of three, we'll say good morning and welcome those who are joining us. Welcome one another. Welcome those who are joining us online. Here we go. One, two, three. Good morning. It's good to be gathered together. It is a beautiful day. So, how many of you have ever seen, we just talked about a bunch of slides, we had slides up here for our last series. How many of you know what a green light means? Green means go. Now, if you're training somebody on how to drive, yield, by the way, means yield. Or yellow means yield. Don't slam on the gas and try to get through it. But green means go. We know that, right? Always. Green means go. So we're going to talk about a time when Jesus says, go. He says, go. In the scripture we're going to read today, the way it's translated, the way that we hear it, is that go and make disciples of all nations. Go and make disciples. So we talked about making disciples of all nations. What we say we're going to do, we're going to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. That's a lot of words that reminds us of what we're here for. Now, the thing that we don't always put on that is the go part. Because we gather here, we worship, that's really important, the work of Jesus, and we're going to hear that the disciples did that, even as they gathered together on this mountain when Jesus told them to go and make disciples. But the going part matters because we don't just stay here. We go into the world. And go means to be active, right? To do something. How many of you have ever been told to go outside? Go outside and play. Right? Go. Go do something. Right? So when we say that we're disciples, and that's that big word at the top of here, that's what we're going to focus on for the next 10 weeks. How are we disciples of Jesus? A disciple is somebody who learns from somebody else. That's where we use the word discipline, too. But a disciple is somebody who learns from somebody else. So when we say that we're disciples of Jesus, we're saying that we're learning from Jesus all the time. And so we have some other words up here. I don't want to go through all of them, but over these next 10 weeks, we're going to talk about some of these words, like grace and mercy and generosity and prayers and scripture, and all because Jesus doesn't say, just go, I'll do anything that I'll let you know about, but Jesus, go and make disciples, teaching them about everything I told you, baptizing them, right? Being part, making everybody part of the community, everybody, no matter who they are, where they live, everybody. And so the ways that we do that, we have to remember that we have to be disciples. We have to be people who are learning from Jesus every day if we want to make disciples. We want that message of love and forgiveness and care to be out there. Now, some of you were here on Tuesday night. We had somebody here talking about bees. It was amazing. It's so interesting. And so there are lots of ways that we can really be part of making disciples. Part of it is thinking about how God created this amazing world. I learned things about bees I've never known. And they are so smart, and they do amazing things. But we're called to care about all that God has created. That's one way we do it. When we talk about following Jesus, we read the stories that we know about Jesus, about his life and ministry, and how we care about people, and that's the kind of thing that we're called to do. Do everything that I've commanded, love God and love each other. And we talk about following the Holy Spirit's guidance. The Holy Spirit's with us always. That's the gift that Jesus gave us. It's the presence of Christ with us all the time. And so we follow the Holy Spirit. We pay attention to maybe that still small voice that reminds us that we belong to God and that God wants to lead us in right paths, in good ways, ways that help us and help others and help the world. So the next time you go through a green light, I want you to remember the green means go, of course. Think about those words that Jesus says to us. Go and make disciples. Go and make disciples. All right, let's pray again. God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for inviting us to be part of the work that you do in the world. For inviting us to care about your beautiful creation. For inviting us to care about one another. And for inviting us pay attention to how your Spirit's at work now, sometimes calling us to go in new directions, to try something new, to be in a relationship with people we haven't met yet, to talk about what you mean to us. So as we go wherever we go, help us to share your love by the things that we say and by the things that we do. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Amen. So part of our work this summer has been to share some of our favorite psalms, and you're invited to continue to do that if you haven't written yours down yet on the sign-in pads. Feel free to do that. We've been now summer and singing some of those, and super interested in the first verse of Because He Lives. It's number 364. Thank you. who is for many days and all that he shared with us. It was so interesting and really, for me, a time to just be amazed by God's creation and how these small things are happening all the time that we may not even notice, and yet they make things grow and make our world what it is. So I was grateful for the education team and their leadership of that. And I want to invite their sister to offer a moment this morning.
Really wasn't quite sure what they meant. To me, it meant God coming in seeing breath. I think that's what I saw. But I got to think what's happened to all of them. That God is always present. He never leaves. It's us that come and go. We don't. We get so wrapped up in our experience of life that we forget to stop and then take time to thank God for what all His does. To me, my God moment this week, back in this morning, when I woke up and I saw my wife, Mary, he brought her into my life over 50 years ago. Thank you. Oh, we got some next year.
So Larry and Mary celebrated their 50th anniversary on Friday, right? And wonderful. Thanks for sharing that with us. As we continue to work together, offer some announcements, some ways that we're in ministry together, some opportunities for us to be in mission together, and an invitation for all to send in those kind of moments. If you're worshiping with us online, you can send them in to the email address there, office@lakeharborumc.org. The same is true for prayer requests. We have an active prayer team here at Lake Harbor, and I know so many people are grateful for the ways that prayers are lifted up for them by folks who receive them whenever they come and take a moment to be in prayer. So, for those who are joining us online, if you're here in the sanctuary, you can fill out prayer requests, those are green slips that we have at the back, blue slips for those moments, put this in the offering plate as part of our offering to God and our community life together. I want to invite you also to take to remember that our newsletters will be coming out soon for September. If you have anything to offer for that you'd like to share in the newsletter, please submit it into the office. We're hoping to have the information by tomorrow so we can start getting that ready. We started our Great Fair program last Monday night, our next session, so that continues to be at 6:30. All are welcome to come. It is a brief support group to support those who have lost a loved one through death, whether recent or not. We're grateful to offer it and thankful for those who have been part of it. I would invite you simply to continue to pray for that mission and ministry. Almost night continues on Tuesday morning. Our youth group is open to have a big day on Tuesday afternoon. On Wednesday night, 5:30, our missions team is hosting private blessings. We did something like this last year. It's basically a gathering and an opportunity to participate in some hands-on mission projects that we can do all together in one week and then bless our community. So look for that. More details will come out on email, but join our missions team on Wednesday for that. Next Monday when we worship on the 27th, we'll have the opportunity to do a blessing of the big pack. We know some schools start this week, some start next week, some after Labor Day. So we want to bless all our students and staff and invite them to bring their backpacks or bags here for that blessing and thank planning for both services next Sunday. We begin to serve Family Promise this next Sunday as well, the 27th of August. And so if you're interested in providing a meal to be delivered to the youth center, we invite you to sign up. We have to sign up electronically. If you need some help with that, you can call the office and we'll make sure to get you connected. But we're grateful to be able to support families who are there and looking for more permanent housing. In the meantime, supporting them with meals, dinner meals, and then also some other food items for the week. So, again, if you haven't taken the opportunity to prepare a meal, and if you can, we'd appreciate your help. Well, our worship committee retreat is coming up on September 8th and 9th. It's a Friday and a Saturday. It's not overnight, but we take time each day to meditate. There's a plan of worship for the next year, and that's been a real gift as pastor here at Lake Harbor. And as we've gone through lots of different series, and we've been able to plan those together in community, it's for a richer and more meaningful experience for all of us. So if you're interested in attending, even if you've never been before, we would love for you to come. You can talk to me or Karen Booth. We'll get you connected and would love to have you there. Because we're thinking about missed opportunities and ministry opportunities and giving opportunities. I want to lift up again Encore's work to respond to the needs in Hawaii. They are partnering with the conference there, the California Pacific Conference, and providing aid as it's needed. So if you want to make a gift, you can simply even make a check to Lake Harbor, make a gift. Market for Encore Hawaii. We'll make sure to get it where it needs to go. You can also get online at Encore's website. So lots of opportunities to give. Our apple tree is going to come down this week. So if you still want to make a donation to Ross Park Elementary School and our partnership with them, I would invite you to take an apple today and do that. It's been a wonderful partnership since 2016 and we'll continue that. The other opportunity we have coming up on the 29th is for anyone who might be interested in being a Ross Tech leader. We have a group of folks who go in 1 hour a week, is the minimum. Some folks do a little more than that, but simply offer support to teachers, sometimes reading with kids, sometimes doing some other work with kids. But it's really, really rewarding, a wonderful partnership that we've had. So if you're interested at all, come to that meeting on the 29th and join us for that. We continue to collect items for your clothing closet, specifically socks. Those will be delivered after our blessings, private blessings this week, if you want to bring any in. And then all of the other opportunities again for kids to invest in. That's ongoing, so lots of opportunities to help. And I'm going to be offering for after storm for disaster response in the Michigan area. So thank you so much for your faithfulness in giving, which makes it possible for us to offer grief share and special events for a certain community, like this past week's volunteers party where we learned so much about bees. Thanks to those who are so faithful in serving in the clothing closet of Matt. And thank you for sending donations as we support needs in our community. During our offering time, we'll read and share those kind of moments and again an invitation for you to write those down and or send them to. And if you take time to offer your gifts, if you're here, there are offering plates or noisy offering buckets at the back of the sanctuary. Otherwise, you can also make a gift online. So we take this time to worship God with our gifts and all that we can offer. Let's take this time.
Thank you.
not just for what you do in our lives, but for who you are in our lives. You are with us in the Holy Trinity, the Father, God above us, the Son, God beside us, and the Holy Spirit, God within us. You empower us to build your kingdom here and now, providing strength and boldness that we would never find on our own. With these gifts, transform the world for your sake. We pray in your holy name. Amen. Continue to be seated. And I invite you to hear these words from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, beginning with verse 16. These are the final words of the Gospel of Matthew. When the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go, when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We pray that God would open our hearts to the reading, hearing, understanding, living of the word, and as we prepare to focus on that word, what I would to remain seated, we'll sing Jesus' name above all names. Hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I still get a little weepy, or at least moved, when I think about the words of a first grader in the classroom I served this past year. Now, he has family church connections and knew that I was a pastor here, and one day when I was leaving after spending some time working with the kids, he looked at me and said, "Take care of the church. Take care of the church." Now, for some reason, in that moment, his words hit me hard, not in a bad way, but in a powerful way, a reminder of my own calling in the pastoral ministry, but even more with the sense that the church mattered. It mattered to him, and he knew it mattered to other people. It needed a care. I don't think he was simply talking about the physical building. I think he was talking about all of us, the congregation, the community, and that matters. Being the church, being the body of Christ, matters. Now, we just spent 10 weeks studying the Ten Commandments in detail, and today we start another series of 10. This time, we focus on discipleship, living as disciples of Jesus Christ. Now, again, we're always talking about discipleship, but we'll take 10 weeks to look at being disciples within the United Methodist tradition, those who follow Jesus as United Methodists today. And today we start with number one, one mission together. So, one mission. Now, you'll see it here. Our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. A quote sounds familiar to you. It's been our mission statement as the larger United Methodist Church for a while. To make disciples of Jesus Christ has been part of our specific identity since 2000, when it was put in the book of discipline. And it comes directly from the words in Matthew's Gospel that we read this morning. The rest of that for the transformation of the world was added in 2008 because of the words of one of our bishops. We seek to join God in the redemption of the whole world. That's a powerful reminder. The work that we do is about the redemption of the whole world that God is already doing, and yet we join that work. Michael Betts says that there are two things that are implicit in that statement. Our mission is to make disciples. Discipleship is one. And for the transformation of the world, a social transformation is the other. That's what we believe our mission is. Discipleship and social transformation. Now, here at Lake Harbor, we claim the mission, and we also see the result, which is the vision you see there, that all people may experience the love of Jesus. And our call, then, how we'll do it is love, welcoming all, empowered by Christ, and forth to serve. That's been part of Lake Harbor's identity for a while. Now, I love intentional words. I love the thought that goes into them. But I know that if that's all we have, it's not enough. A mission statement is great, and a vision and a call are great. So there's that challenge for us, whether we've been connected to the United Methodist Church for a long time or not, whether we carry history from other traditions as well, whether we've been part of any church for a while. What does it mean for us to be disciples? Many of us have learned pieces of church history and theology and transformation in our new members' classes, but looking at who we are, always looking at who we are and who we're called to be as disciples, is important. It's vital. And so this might be a refresher of sorts, but I hope that we can be strengthened in our faith, even as we're aware, no doubt you're aware, as I am, pastors read lots of things and work on lots of things, you're aware of religious connection decline. Decline in religious connection for many people and decreasing loyalty to denominations. Now, maybe a long time ago you just saw the cross in flame on the church and you went, oh, that's the Methodist church, that's where I'm going to go. That's not the case anymore. And I hope that we reflect on why all this matters and ask a challenging question for ourselves, because that's important. Would my life be different without Jesus? And without the community of faith, no matter your history, where you've been, how has Jesus changed it? How has it being part of the community of faith changed it? And other questions that I think are important. How am I participating in that mission to make disciples, the transformation of the world? How am I living as a disciple? Every year, usually in the fall, we're intentional about making faith commitments, offering a pledge of prayers, presence, faith, service, and witness that will come in October, don't worry. We call it a stewardship focus, but it's really a part of this larger journey of discipleship that we're on. And so, in many ways, we're called to always talk about discipleship, not just stewardship. Stewardship alone doesn't really describe the whole of who we're called to be. We're called to be disciples, learners, who walk with the one whose ways we learn and who walk together, called into community by Christ. Now, I take great consolation that Jesus promises to be with us after he commands, and he offers the command at the end of the Gospel of Matthew to make disciples. Now, to go and make disciples, to go is really important. And if you're somebody who really loves grammar, it's interesting to you, because it's interesting to me. It's really not simply go, it's as you're going, make disciples. After all, if our mission is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, we have to be disciples of Jesus Christ. We're actively working to transform the world where we are. And wherever we are, wherever we go, whatever we do, we're called to live in a way that points to Christ and help others find life in Christ. Now, we know that God is the one who ultimately does that work, and yet the seeds we plant are important. You have seeds planted in your life that matter, that help you be a disciple. even as I think about it, I'm thinking about numerous people who are part of that journey for me, and maybe those names and faces come to your mind too. Michael Beck advocates for us to remember the go part of the Great Commission. The go part's important. We can't assume that people will come to us, because they won't. Those days are over. That's right, there are millions of people who are not connected to any church and never will be in its current form. They're not going to walk into Sunday morning worship, no matter how we do it. These are people that we know and love, friends, colleagues, co-workers, family, children, grandchildren, who will never know the preciousness of communal life in Jesus if we don't go embody it with them. That's a lot to say, and that's a powerful word and a reminder of where we are. I love that phrase, communal life with Jesus. What does it mean to have that communal life with Jesus? That's really the blessing we share and invite people into. Belonging to a church and being connected to a congregation, may be important to us, but notice the words that Jesus uses. Jesus doesn't talk about being a member. He talks about being a disciple. He doesn't say, go make members of the church. He says, go make disciples. Now, there's nothing wrong with taking our membership seriously. For some of us, choosing to take membership vows was an important step on our faith journey. I remember when I was confirmed as a teenager, I think it was probably eighth grade or so, it was a big deal to stand before God and my church family and make a public commitment to follow Christ. I just saw one of my lifelong childhood friends, and she and I were part of that confirmation class together. We still talk about how meaningful that was to be together. But the moment I became a member of the church wasn't the end of it. It was part of the whole journey, the discipleship journey. Being a disciple of Jesus is lifelong, where we're constantly growing and changing and being challenged to be more like Jesus in every area of our lives. And it's not about replicating ourselves. The idea about making disciples, it's not really replication, but engaging in relationships with others, that communal life with Jesus that builds a community that transforms the world. I was thinking about it this week. I don't know that I would be connected to the things that I'm connected to without the church. I don't know that I would have ever served in some of the places that I serve without the church. I miss my church as a kid, even being connected to benefit various people now as an adult and as a pastor. That matters. So what does it mean to you to follow Jesus, not simply to be a member of the church? How it's changed your life? Because there's something implicit here, too, about our lives being changed. If disciples transform the world, then it would sort of mean, too, that our lives are transformed so that the world might look a little more like the kingdom than before. That's the goal of discipleship, to transform the world. Disciples follow and make a commitment to be part of the body of Christ, to become more like Jesus, and to join Jesus in ministry. That's everything. There isn't an area of our lives that isn't affected by Jesus' call. To follow and learn and to grow and change. Being a disciple of Jesus isn't automatic either. It takes time and attention and our open heart to God's leading and guiding. And it's interesting to look at the logistics of what we read in the Gospel of Matthew. Jesus takes the disciples to a mountain in Galilee. Now, remember that right before this, if you look at Matthew 28, we hear the resurrection story there, and they are in Jerusalem. And if you know anything about geography, or if you look at the map, which is what I tend to do, it's quite a hike from Jerusalem to Galilee. It's not a quick trip. And Galilee was Gentile country. And so Jesus brings the disciples away from that central coveted spot of God's presence in Jerusalem and goes where people might not think that God is present. Go. be God is always present everywhere. Those whom Jesus calls to the mountainhead have been with him for 3 years. They have watched and listened and learned and struggled and shared and helped and questioned and wondered along the way. And even when Jesus brings them there, Matthew says that some doubted. They worshiped, but some doubted. Can you blame them? Remember when this happens, because after resurrection, they've been through quite an ordeal, and now Jesus has risen from the dead and has called them together. And he explains his divine power. All that they've experienced with him is because he is God's Son, sent by God to bring salvation to a needy world. So then he breaks the news and gives them the things that he wants them to do. So that starts to go and make disciples is sometimes called Great Commission. We're commissioned to do something. And it is Great Commission. It's a huge task. His disciples have recently heard of Jesus' resurrection. The God is still fresh, but they'll fulfill this commission by remembering what we talked about in that last series as we talked about the commandments. So fulfill the commission by following the Great Commandment to love God and to love neighbor. Being a disciple is about my relationship with Jesus, how Jesus is active in my life, and how that relationship is linked out where I am connected in my congregation, in my community, in my home, wherever I am. Jesus sends his followers into a world where social issues were very real, power struggles between military rulers and religious leaders were real, issues around what following God was supposed to look like. Very real, trying to live together with many differences. Very real. It's around finances and the money and the love of money. All of them very real. It was all there in this moment when the disciples are sent out after Jesus has been crucified for his ministry. Crucified and risen. Alive. That he might offer new life and hope. And he's calling us, all of us, to make disciples so that the kingdom of God may be seen on earth, even if only a glimpse, here and now. That's what it made me think of that day when the young Stevie said, take care of the church. There was a kingdom moment there. We're all part of taking care of it. We're called to engage in discipling relationships as we live as disciples. So what does that look like for you? Who are the people around you who may not have a connection, who may need to hear your witness? Not to fear, not to stoke fear, but to invite them into loving relationship, to hear how Christ has made a difference in your life. And why it matters to you. That is a powerful witness to people to hear. Now, going back to where we are in the Gospel of Matthew, the first thing that happens, remember, when the disciples do see Jesus, is that they worship him. Even in a confusing and emotional time, worship is still first and most important. It's our primary way of honoring God, staying connected to Jesus, and helping each other grow. It puts things in perspective, reminding us of who we are and who and whom we belong. And that God is worthy, the only one worthy of our worship. And the second thing is that Jesus immediately gives them a three-part assignment. Go, baptize and teach. And again, if you're somebody who likes grammar and translation, form. For our friends that use it more often than we do in the North, it's the y'all. This isn't just for leaders, but everyone who follows Jesus. I was asking me yesterday, what's the sermon on tomorrow? And I said, it's the women's disciples. He goes, isn't that just your job? Thanks. She's learned well. For everyone who follows Jesus, go to all people, not just those who are like you or those whom you like. Go to all people, all nations. And this doesn't necessarily mean going away from where you live. There are people all around around us. How do we live that out? Does our faith go outside these doors, or is it being picked up in these seats to pick up when we return again? How does it show itself in authentic, helpful ways in our everyday interactions? At the heart of the gospel is Jesus, our Savior, who commands us to go. To go out from here, to be people of action, doing His work every day. As we serve God, we work in relationship with God and with each other. We can't be disciples alone. We can't make disciples alone. It's written that Jesus calls the group up to that mountain to be commissioned. Our ministry is not individual. It's not self-serving. We have gifts that are unique to us, to be sure, but we offer them in community with each other. We have power and support through the grace of Christ. We're in ministry because God calls us and empowers us, and ministry can't happen without the power of Jesus Christ, the risen one, who calls us up to those mountains, all of us, and sends us back to be people who make the world more like God's kingdom. Jesus is the one who takes us to places of mission and vision, and they're rooted in His grace. And since that small group gathered together on the mountain long ago, the message of God's love made real in Christ has spread and reached millions. God reaches people of all experiences, walks of life, and God uses us to form those discipling relationships that we might share what we know. It's that call to relationships that are imbued with the love of Jesus and a passion for sharing what we've experienced by receiving and extending His love. It is so important to be able to share what we know. How we've been saved by ministries where people shared that love with us. And again, think of those people who have lived their faith, who have given God the glory, who have persevered through difficult times that you and I can't imagine, who have spoken of God's grace in their lives. I serve as part of a team of facilitators for a group of new pastors, and one of them, who is coming through our process, shared his story of being a refugee, an experience I can't even fathom, but being able to worship together in the refugee camp and how God transformed his life. It's an amazing story here. But that's what it was. It was this story of discipleship, how it changed him, how it moved him, how God is real in his life in the midst of difficult times. And remembering that we're always moving on, moving forward in faith with Jesus at our side. And sure, some people say, it's uncomfortable, it's risky, it's hard to talk about it. But considering the way that the early church grew, we know that these disciples took Jesus' call seriously. It's work every day. It means that we're inviting others to know the love of Christ, even as we're seeking to be more like Christ, because we cannot make disciples unless we are disciples. Those discipling relationships matter. They have to be authentic. They have to draw out who we are. Jesus says to teach everything He's already taught. There's no new curriculum to create. Disciples tell others what they've experienced, and so can we. We can love God and love neighbor, though I know it's easier said than done some days. We can reclaim a call to evangelism. Evangelism simply means to share the good news that we know about Jesus. What's the good message that others need to know? Our words and actions can show Jesus compassion and bring healing and include those who feel like outsiders and give new life. That is Jesus' message all the time. But it's always risky, isn't it, to be part of Jesus' ministry? Love's risky. Jesus is on the loose and the world's unpredictable. We don't know how the Spirit's going to move, and we don't know where the Spirit's going to move. But we have to know. It happens all the time. And I wonder if that's why Jesus reassures the disciples. Yes, we're called to action, but the final thing we learn is that we live out His remember, I am with you always. Always, even to the very end of the age, even until the kingdom comes in its fullness, I am with you always. As we focus on our faith journey, we'll look at our history and remember those who've been kept with our identity, both as individuals and as Christians in the world. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, is credited with offering these words on his deathbed, a reminder of God's faithfulness and steadfast presence. The best thing of all is God is with us. We'll learn more about Wesley as we go through this series, but that's a powerful word. And that's a word from the Great Commission, too. I'm being with you always. The best thing is that God is with us. Those words are true. We can trust what Jesus says. We can be certain of his presence, and we don't do this work alone, but together with Christ, as people loved by God, redeemed by Christ, and empowered by the Spirit. Sometimes we just pray this morning. God, we pray for the church and for the world. Pray that you would help us see the two of them intertwined because we're called to make disciples for Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. We are part of the world that you created, that you called us to love. We are part of the world that Christ died for. And so hear our prayers today that you would help us to be united in our love for you, to be converting your love and to reveal your glory for the world in authentic and honest and powerful ways as we talk about your grace in our lives. Guide us in this country, in every nation, in the ways of justice and peace. And we lift up to you those things, those sins in our lives and in our world that need to be eradicated. Help us to love each other, each of us beloved. May all the sins, the isms that we carry, be left at your altar and be healed. Help us honor one another and to serve the common good. Let's care for the earth as your good creation, to use its resources rightly in service to others and to your honor and your glory, to be faithful stewards of all that you do to us. We pray for those whose names and faces come to our minds, those whose lives are closely linked to ours. And we pray for those who we may never meet, and yet we know who are in need of your loving care, for people around the world, living in the midst of hunger and famine and war and conflict and oppression and uncertainty, for those recovering after natural disasters, wondering what is next, and for the people responding on the ground. Keep us always aware of the ways that we can share your love, certainly with prayer, but even more with action, with advocacy, with resources. Be with those who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles. Give them the joy of knowing your presence. And remind us to pray for them, to reach out to them in love and care in the name of Christ. Hear our prayers today, O God, in the strength of your steadfast love, as we pray the prayer of Jesus Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would you stand if you're comfortable, and we'll sing a song. This is called Go to the World. It's new words for us, but the tune is probably for worship. As people of faith, we go into the world. Go and share the story of faith, the story of life and hope with the world around you. We share our faith in word and in deed, in speech and in action. As we go out to give a living witness, as we go out to testify to God's love active in the world, we go knowing that God goes with you, that God is with us always. Friends, go in peace.